Summer is here, and for many Calgary kids, this year marked the end of their high school career. A recent study has found that a huge number of them are leaving grade 12 with habits they didn't have when they entered high school. The University of Waterloo surveying more than 31,000 teens when it looked at their involvement in risky behaviors. It found a huge jump in such activity from grade 9 to grade 12. Listen to this, a 124% increase in the number of marijuana users from grade 9 to 12. 167% increase in binge drinkers. For smokers, 170% jump from grade 9 until graduation. Should we be surprised by these numbers? Is this just a reflection of an age group that takes risks without worrying about consequences? Someone who is very familiar with this is Tibor Palatinus. He is a drug prevention specialist with Narconon Vancouver Society. He joins us today. Hello, Tibor.
Hi, Angela. Pleasure to be here.
First of all, explain Narconon for people who aren't familiar with your organization.
Well, what our society does in Vancouver is it specializes in getting drug prevention materials out to Canadian school teachers across Canada. So we have we look for the best prevention materials we can find, and we get them to Canadian school teachers for free. They just need to request it. Actually, if any teachers are interested, they can go to communitydrugeducation.org, and I think there's a section that says school teachers or school requests. They can just click on that and request a DVD, and we'll send to you out a program. So that's our main focus in Canada. We also send people to rehab who are looking to live a drug-free life. So we support abstinence-based models of drug prevention and abstinence-based models of drug rehabilitation.
All right, then. You are the person I wanted to talk to about this survey. When I hear numbers like 124% increase from grade 9 to 12 when it comes to, let's say, marijuana, binge drinkers, 167, if I'm trying to get my mind around these numbers, that sounds like anyone who was in grade 9 when they're leaving grade 12, they've got some big problems.
Yeah, that's exactly correct. You're looking at increases of usage, increases of risk activity, and we've been saying this for years in Narconon. What happens when a student is given insufficient information regarding drugs and alcohol, or they're being covertly or overtly promoted or marketed to through media or other efforts, they're going to be using more drugs. That's what goes on.
I want to focus on, let's say, marijuana, just because that to me would be your area of expertise. Am I correct?
It is. Marijuana and alcohol, absolutely.
All right, then. We can cover the binge drinking part of this equation as well. Binge drinking, what's the definition of binge drinking?
Five servings, whatever a serving would equate to, would be five beers, five shots, I believe five glasses of wine, same, in a short period of time, generally 2 to 5 hours of time would elapse over that period, and that's what that's when an individual is binge drinking.
And that only has to be, let's say, once a week, and you could be considered a binge drinker?
If you were doing it in a condensed period of time, that would be an instance of binge drinking. But whether a person's a binge drinker, if he does that once a week or she does it once a week, that's a debatable point. That gets into alcohol and abuse and things like that. So it's let's not cut hairs. When a student underage who shouldn't be drinking is drinking that amount, usually they're drinking that and more frequently. It's rare that if a high school student is binge drinking, that they do it once, which is okay, that's fine, not a big deal. They've done it once, they tried it, they got sick. But when they're repeatedly doing it, that's absolutely a problem, and that's a problem for anybody, actually.
I want to talk about the problem. What is happening when an individual, and in this case we are focusing on a young person, an underage individual, what is happening to them physiologically when they are consuming that amount of alcohol in such a short period of time?
Well, there's lots going on, and this is the problem. When you have a young, developing body, developing brain, a developing nervous system and organs, and you shock it with that amount of alcohol. Now, I'm going to define a word for many individuals who are listening who do not have the definition of this, and that's the definition of a drug, which alcohol is one. The major problem with drugs and alcohol is that they're misdefined. And drug or alcohol is essentially a poison. That's what we say, tell kids and adults at Narconon all the time. You're dealing with a poison. It's the quantity that a person takes which determines its effect. Mm. A small amount of alcohol will give you a stimulant. Anyone who's had a beer or half a glass of wine will feel a stimulant. It'll raise their heart rate and so on. If they have many more, it'll act as the same drug, same alcohol, will act as a depressant. It'll start putting them to sleep. And if they drink a lot more quickly enough, it can kill them. Alcohol poisoning, people choking in their own vomit, things like that. And now that's the immediate effect. The longer-term effect of continued alcohol use or abuse, especially amongst young people, really is things like brain damage. We see brain shrinkage in individuals who are drinking a lot of alcohol. So it's a dangerous thing to be doing, period. But as a younger person, it can and does alter physiology. It does alter brain function. It slows development, which we see a lot of. And that's, you know, those are the negative sides that I believe they need to be explained, but that's really not the cause of binge drinking, actually. I don't know if you'd be interested in talking a little bit about that now.
And you know what I do? After the break, my guest this half hour, Tibor Palatinus, he is a drug prevention specialist with Narconon Vancouver Society. Back with Tibor and the causes after this. Interesting discussion this afternoon just about teens developing chronic diseases as a result of their risky behavior in those high school years, and the numbers are quite alarming. Tibor Palatinus is a drug prevention specialist with Narconon Vancouver Society, and he works with high school. He wants to make sure kids at that age level are getting the right information. If you want more information on Narconon, or maybe you're an educator, you can go to communitydrugeducation.org and you can find out more information as well there. Tibor, just before the break, we were talking specifically about binge drinkers and the numbers and what can happen to that individual's brain and their body. But we wanted to back up a bit and maybe look more at the causes of binge drinking. What have you found?
This is really interesting information. Back almost, well, over 10 years ago, and even prior to that, Narconon had done a lot of surveys as, you know, to why kids abuse drugs, why kids abuse alcohol. And we saw there was an amazing correlation. When a particular event occurred, there was, over the next several years, there was an increase of abuse and usage of particular drugs. MDMA, ecstasy, mm-hmm. alcohol abuse, marijuana abuse, always followed. You saw a spike of increase of usage, always following several specific events. And these events were very, very pronounced. I'm sure the listeners would love to find out what they are.
Yes.
It was movies. The Hangover, Fast and Furious, movies, you know, unfortunately, by our, you know, one and only Canadian actor, Seth Rogen, Pineapple Express, Superbad, Knocked Up. You see alcohol abuse or binge drinking or risky or dangerous behavior, if you will, you know, extreme behavior in a movie, and within a couple of months, or in some cases as long as 6 months to a year after, you see increases of binge drinking, increases of marijuana usage, increases of MDMA or ecstasy usage in high school students. We saw it over and over again. And so what we discovered is that there these movies, TV shows, commercials promoting extreme behavior in a funny way. This was the key thing we discovered. They had these movies and shows had to be delivered with humor. And so it didn't look dangerous. When you're laughing at a guy, you know, stone falling down, getting drunk, and falling over himself, we laugh. We don't go, oh, that's dangerous. And when humor was introduced into these situations in the movies or in the commercials, we saw an increase of abuse amongst high school students. It was one for one. You see, the movie comes out, the result occurs. Great examples you can see in Molson Canadian commercials. Really funny, truly Canadian. What do we see in Canadian students? Increases of heavy beer drinking, increases of risky behavior, and it goes again and again and again. So this is the one major thing in drug prevention education that teachers need to be educated on, parents need to be educated on, is how to find out when you as a parent, you as a student, you as a teenager, you as a teacher are being covertly marketed to. And that's what, in my opinion, and you know, from my point of view, that's what is going on when you see the glorification of weed, the glorification of MDMA, the glorification of alcohol.
So there are lots of influences. And sure, a simple solution would be you can't watch any of those things. You can't go to those movies. You've got to turn the TV off. Oh, gosh, you know, kids don't even watch TV nowadays. They've got it bombarded with their computers and their smartphones. But how do we balance that? Because realistically, they are going to want to go to those movies. How do we make sure that they aren't influenced by those movies?
Ah, that's actually a great question. This leads right into prevention, Angela. We believe in Narconon never, ever say no to a kid regarding their abuse or their use. Let them, give them the information. You know, when a young person is given facts about a drug, for example, with marijuana, you know, most marijuana smokers do not know that that marijuana can stay with them for months and sometimes years. It stores deeply in the body fat and can slow down their thinking process, can cause them to continue to abuse later on, even when they try to quit. It stores in the body fat. This is this is a big deal. Most marijuana smokers don't know that. With alcohol, even a little bit of alcohol will damage the brain. Now, it's up to the individual to make that choice of whether they're going to use or not. When I say, I'd like to expose the influences. For example, if you knew you were being advertised or marketed to, you'd put your armor up and you go, hey, go ahead, try to sell me something. I know you're trying to sell me something. Now, the likelihood of you buying that thing that someone's trying to sell you is low. You're aware, you know what's going on. However, when you go to a movie, when you, and sometimes when you're watching a really funny commercial, you forget you're being sold to. And I'm just letting, what we do is we show people how the positioning of marijuana to fun, alcohol to camaraderie, alcohol positioned next to having breakthroughs in groups and, winning friends over. This is called, it's a tactic in advertising called positioning. You position what you want to sell, the marijuana, the alcohol, next to something fun or desirable, friendship, things like that. And by explaining this to kids, when the kids see it, they start pointing out all the places where cigarettes are being advertised or marketed or alcohol is or weed is or MDMA is. And you simply help them observe these blatant, in my opinion, blatant marketing tactics, and what happens as a result is the kids become not quite immune, but they can easily deflect these things, and they start laughing about the obvious, marketing that they see. You know, when the ad for Smirnoff comes in, the actor, pulls out the Smirnoff right at the right moment. They just realize they're being marketed to, or McDonald's flashes across the screen, in a key place in the movie. It's blatant marketing.
Awareness is power, of course. Knowledge is power.
Bingo. But so yeah, we cannot as parents, educators, teachers, we cannot prevent kids from observing things, but we can make them or educate them in what to look for so they're not being tricked. Because being deceived, you know, when a person, you know, is being deceived, they really resent it. And when they discover they're being tricked or attempted to being tricked, they will, you know, take offense to that. And that's essentially what we do in any, you know, of our drug prevention activities with Narconon or any of the DVDs we get out, because we promote anyone's DVDs and drug prevention programs that are effective. You know, we don't care. If it's effective and it's getting results, we promote it. And we're doing that now with communitydrugeducation.org. We've got some really good, excellent products that are available for teachers. And, you know, all you have to do is ask.
Tibor, I'm glad we could spread the message today. Thanks so much for your expertise in the area.
You're very welcome, Angela. It's a really pleasure talking with you.
Tibor Palatinus, a drug prevention specialist with Narconon Vancouver Society.